2. In series, we've got R is equal to R1 plus R2. And VAB is equal to V1 plus V2. And then in parallel, and VAB is equal to V1, which is equal to V2. So the voltage across each of the resistors is the same. Just as we had with parallel and series filled capacitors. Alright, so that leads us to Kirchhoff's rules. Which are rather simply stated, sum of the I is equal to 0, which is the junction rule, and the sum of V is equal to 0, which is the loop rule. Alright, so if I go around any loop in a direct current circuit, the sum of the voltages around that loop has to be equal to 0. If I go into and out of an injunction, the sum of whatever the currents into an injunction and out of an injunction must also be 0. Right? So usually what I would do is say that any currents going into the junction are positive, and any currents going out of the junction are negative. Right? And then the other thing that to keep in mind when I'm doing the loop rule, right, is that if I go in, usually I want to travel in the direction of positive from negative terminal of the EMF to a positive terminal of the EMF. That means that my electromotive force would be positive if I travel across it. Right? And then if I'm traveling in the direction of the current, if I'm traveling around my loop in the direction of the current, I go across the resistor, there's a drop in voltage across the resistor. So voltage is negative across the resistor and positive across the EMF if I'm traveling in the direction of the current. If I travel the opposite direction of the current, then it's negative across the EMF and positive across the resistors. Right? Okay, so just sort of to remind ourselves about that. Okay, if we put together a resistor and a capacitor, we can produce an RC circuit. RC circuits, we get a decay in the amount of charge on, say for instance I have a capacitor charged and then some time zero, I close a switch and I get a decay in the charge on that capacitor as a function of time, and it eventually goes to, an increase in the charge on the capacitor if it's uncharged to begin at the beginning. Dk in the current, excuse me, E to the minus T over C. So this is if it's charging the capacitor. And then alternatively, I get Q is equal to Q0, 1 minus, Q is equal to Q0, E to the minus T over C, and I is equal to minus Q0 over RC, E to the minus T over RC, if this is discharging. All right, so the other thing I was just going to mention, I'm not going to actually put it on the sheet, but household wiring, we actually use alternating current instead of DC current. And there's a grounding wire or plug that protects us against excess current, for instance. So I don't want to spend too much time on that because I want to get to magnetic fields. Alright, so magnetic force on moving charge is given by QB cross B, where B is our magnetic field. This follows the right-hand rule, as much of the things in magnetism do. So if, for instance, I have some charge, let's say it's a positive charge, for the sake of simplicity, is moving along its into the screen here, then the force as a result will be in the upward direction. And that's due to the right hand rule. I take my fingers, I point them in the direction of V, I curl my fingers towards V, then my thumb gives me the direction of the force. Okay. Just like electric fields, I can have magnetic field lines and magnetic flux. As I did before, so magnetic flux, phi B, is equal to the integral of B dot dA. Looks familiar, right? Field lines, in this case though, point in the direction compass points. From north to south. And do you remember what that says about the, for instance, the for the magnetic field of Earth's magnetic fields? So what pole do we have at the north pole of the Earth, or near the north pole of the Earth? It's a south magnetic pole, right? Because the north pole of our compass points towards the north pole of the Earth, and therefore we have a south magnetic pole at the north pole of the Earth. Okay, or excuse me, we have a south magnetic pole at the geographic